Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure today to welcome Amanda Clarke to the school and to Queen's. Amanda is an assistant professor in the School of Public Policy and Administration at Carleton, one of our competitors, but we don't hold that against her. From 2010 to 2014, she was at Oxford University as a Trudeau Fellow, a Shirk Fellow, and lots of other people helping her to complete her doctorate at Oxford, where she was exploring digital government in Canada and the United Kingdom, which is a nice comparison. Now she's researching digital era policy design, public sector innovation, open government, civic technologies in Canada, and she, again, is doing that in a comparative perspective, looking at Canada and other international examples. And she has been talking to governments and international organizations about how you manage the policy process in the digital age. So I'm very much looking forward to what she has to tell us today. Amanda, thank you for coming.
Thank you. How's that
working?
Okay, great. First of all, thanks a lot for having me. I always really enjoy coming to Queen's, and I'm really impressed at the number of people who are here on a Friday. This is great. I rarely get an audience this large, so I'm really eager to hear what you have to say. I think these talks are as useful for me as hopefully they're going to be useful to you, in the sense that it allows me to work through some ideas and actually to hear feedback, good and bad. So if any of this you want to challenge, that's especially useful. So I'm going to try to leave plenty of time for questions and answers, but I guess I'll jump right into it. So I was asked by Margaret Biggs to give a talk on policy innovation, which is great, because I think that's a really relevant topic, whether you're planning on moving forth into a career in the public service or outside the public service, advocating to or trying to support the work of government, or if you're planning on moving into any kind of further research in the field. I would say that this is an area ripe for new evaluations, and there's lots of empirical work to be done. If you sort of were to peruse any kind of public sector reform agenda, document, or claims, promises being made across the globe and at all levels of government, you'll find the word innovation kind of sprinkled throughout. And of course, that's because innovation, it just sounds good. I mean, why wouldn't you want to be innovative? But there are sort of concrete reasons that this is actually being put on the agenda in a real way, and that and I'm going to go through some of those as the presentation develops. And it isn't just sort of a buzzword or a fad. It is, in many ways, resulting in concrete commitments and efforts to try to produce a public sector that is better able to embrace new ideas, to adapt to change, and to introduce new policy instruments and approaches into its toolkit. So some examples that you might see is Denmark has a innovation lab called Mind Lab. This one on the bottom is the Social Innovation Lab of Kent. At the top, you see the Innovation Hub, which is an innovation lab that was introduced to the Privy Council Office in recent years. So this is one part of the phenomenon, is the creation of these dedicated hubs and units at the center of government often, or sort of as quasi-governmental bodies that support innovation. Track Changes is a podcast the federal government is now running to describe and sort of explore the challenges that innovators and government face, and is really worth following if any of you are interested in having a sense of what's happening in that scene in Ottawa. But you're also seeing things like, so in addition to labs and hubs, experimentation commitments. So this kind of like was brushed over by many people, but I think now many are sort of realizing the power it's going to have. So Scott Bryson, leading the Treasury Board now in Ottawa, has a commitment in his mandate letter made open by Prime Minister Trudeau to ensure that every department dedicates a fixed percentage of program funds to experimentation. As a kind of hilarious example of one of the reasons governments are not particularly innovative, which I'll get into a bit more in the presentation, I met with some folks at Treasury Board to discuss how they were going to implement this, and they had spent at this point about 6 or 7 months debating what that even meant. Like, is it the same fixed percentage for all departments? Because that could get kind of crazy when you think about small ones and big ones. And what does it mean by experimentation? So is it just sort of generally being open to new ideas, or are we talking about like hardcore randomized controlled trials, and sort of every other consideration in between. And I kind of asked them, perhaps naively, like, why don't you just ask the minister? And they were like, oh, that's an interesting idea. So, I mean, we'll get into some of the problems of bulky process and hierarchy, but nonetheless, I think this experimentation commitment is definitely one to watch and is a really interesting innovation, innovation in and of itself. And then finally, there's been a real push across governments, in particular on the digital side, to recruit new skills and talent into government. So often what the new skills that are being asked are not kind of in your typical policy program. I mean, I've sort of reviewed what we offer across Canada in terms of Masters of Public Policy, Masters of Public Admin, and we don't actually provide training on many of these new and emerging and increasingly popular policy skills. So things like behavioral insights, design thinking, data analytics. Where these are coming from more are things like design schools, certain economics programs, emerging data science programs. So there's also an argument to be made that actually the kinds of, and governments are indeed really sort of considering how they need to change their sort of traditional feeder disciplines to the public service. So these are some of the ways that I think the push for innovation is actually not just a kind of flighty fad. There are concrete programs underway to try to implement this. So the outline for today that I'm going to follow is first to describe, so why is innovation on the agenda? Why is this something that governments are turning to? The second, what are the barriers to innovation in government? And then third, to end on a bit of a positive note, so how do we actually foster innovation? And what are some practical, and I say idealistic strategies, because some of the ideas that I'll put forth, you are rightfully going to say, ha, yeah, right, that'll never happen. But I do think if we don't say it, it really never will happen. So I'm happy to be a bit of a idealist on that. I'm still young in my career, so I get to say these kinds of hopeful things. I haven't yet become jaded. I think things can change. It's crazy. Okay, so the first point, why innovation? Why is this something that governments are turning to? These are the reasons that are typically put forth, and many of you will know, like, these are not new. I could have been giving a presentation in 1970 on what challenges are facing government, and in particular, the first three would be there. So wicked problems, so the idea of challenges that are kind of have multiple perspectives, multiple issues at play, multiple sectors at play. There's no easy solutions. Stakeholder diversity and complexity. So increasingly, governments are realizing that they don't actually have the levers that they to pull that are needed to affect the social change they intend to change. So there's an awareness that they have to cooperate more across different levels of government, across different departments, and across and with citizens and citizen groups, private industry, etc. The third one is a big one: fiscal constraints. So I mean, governments always complain, you know, it's hard to, we don't have enough resources. But I mean, if you actually look at the federal level, at least, government spending as a portion of GDP is at levels as low as post-war periods. And in fact, also the individual tax burden in Canada, which is something people don't really think about, but the individual tax burden in Canada now is, again, as low as it's been since post-World War II period. So we are living in a time of sort of, If you have a government in power that wants to do a lot, which I would say the federal government does right now, it's kind of like champagne dreams on a Coca-Cola budget. There is just no money. So there really is, unless we take Alex Himmelfarb's advice and stop treating tax like a four-letter word and we actually talk about the revenue gap, we are facing governments who need to really do more with less and find creative solutions. The last two, I bold here because I think these are kind of newer and more relevant in recent years. So certainly things like the rapid pace at which new technologies, policy instruments, sources of information and data are emerging, both as new tools that governments can use to solve problems, but also as phenomena that need to be regulated. So things like robotics, artificial intelligence, big data analytics, these are all, in many cases, offer great opportunities for government, but also there's an awareness, okay, actually, how do we manage these as new facets of society and ensure that we're, you know, aware of the many dimensions and issues that they raise. A great example would be Uber, which I think, you know, many governments were kind of caught completely unprepared to regulate this this emerging economy, and the regulatory responses have been sort of spotty and in many cases very ineffective. The second sort of new challenge that I think puts innovation on the agenda is changing and rapidly changing citizen expectations for service, responsiveness from service providers. The last two, transparency and participation, I'm a little bit more wary on. I mean, it's kind of a like taken for granted fact that people say, oh, Canadians want to participate more. We don't actually have a lot of great data to suggest that, or they expect to participate more. I mean, if most studies would, if you actually looked at what citizens think about government, they don't expect they're going to have many chances to shape it, and they're pretty jaded about how democratically responsive government is. But I think there is a sense that, at least on certain files, like the rise of e-petitions, let's say, or the way in which Canadians are turning to something like Twitter as an interesting way of expressing their political preferences, it's really challenging government to think about how it engages the public in its work. So the question that I think is often being posed in response to all these pressures is, you know, is government's metabolic rate fast enough to keep pace with a rapidly changing world? So can government change, adapt, embrace opportunity, mitigate risks fast enough for a world that is sort of bombarding it with new challenges daily? And the image that I like to use is of kind of like a stream. So if you imagine, I mean, societies have never been sort of stagnant. There's always been change and new challenges that are facing government. And you know, I think we were all sort of aware of the fact that governments, for a whole range of reasons, were always a little bit behind the curve. You know, on certain issues, we know governments can be very innovative. For example, the internet came out of the U.S. military. But as a general rule, governments can't move as fast as many other sectors for a whole range of very good reasons. Like there's concerns around equity and fair provision of services, and sometimes the processes that slow governments down are the very ones that make them democratically accountable. So we're okay with that. I'm not asking government to be like Google, let's be clear. But if you sort of imagine that like the pace of change traditionally has been this sort of like battling brook stream type situation, and government kind of dips in and pulls out a cup and figures out like how it's going to work with this substance at that moment in time, and by the time it figures out how to work with it and have sip, yes, the stream has continued and they're behind the times, but at least they're sort of, you know, from time to time relatively able to keep pace. But now I think the pace of change is more like a cascading waterfall. So when governments kind of dip in and take however long it's going to take them to figure out how to deal with that new moment in time, that new wave of policy challenges or new opportunities or citizen expectations, they're that much further behind because the pace of change has sort of amplified. And this is, I think, really why that question of, is our metabolic rate of change sort of fast enough? Can we keep pace? Is something that governments are really realizing they need to address head on, because the response is almost always no. So policy innovation then emerges, on the one hand, as a way to kind of quicken government's metabolic rate, to do more with less in times of fiscal constraint, to meet changing expectations, and to benefit from a whole new range of policy instruments and approaches that, in particular, the digital age makes possible. So quickly, helpful to define what I mean by policy innovation then. You can think of it as kind of like a noun and a verb, or an output and a process. So in terms of noun or output, an innovation could just be sort of an actual innovation that government implements, like a new service design or something. Increasingly, though, I think the interest is in particular in the process of innovation, and that gets at this question of the metabolic rate of government. So it's a means of identifying problems, solutions, prototyping, and experimenting, and kind of, in many cases, sort of rejecting the long-term internal development cycle that governments have traditionally followed, in which, you know, there's sort of years of, or in the best cases, months of developing a policy response without ever kind of just trying something in a small scale, seeing what works, taking data in, and rapidly changing the approach in response to data, or engaging with stakeholders early to see what works and what doesn't. So a big part of innovation then is failure, because you're trying things and you know, you're gonna put 10 options on the table and you're expecting 9 of them to fail and 1 to be optimal, and that's the one you implement. And again, they rely on this sort of iteration and continual testing and user engagement versus that kind of long-term internal development cycle, in which, you know, by the time you launch a policy, a service, or a program, there's already sort of so many sunk costs that, you know, and you kind of put it out into the world, and you're like, oh, that actually doesn't work. Whoops, we spent a year and a half developing it and X number of dollars, and the minister does not want to hear now that we're not doing it, so we're just going to go ahead with it anyways. And, you know, you can think of countless examples where government failures were really the product of not kind of early testing. And that's, again, what the innovation drive is pushing towards in governments. So all of that sounds great, but of course, you know, innovation and this process of kind of really testing out solutions early, being prepared to fail, being more iterative and agile and data-driven is kind of the exception and not the norm. It's something we're striving towards, but not something we've achieved. So what are the barriers to innovation? And these will be, anybody who's worked in government will be very familiar with these. Anybody who has, you know, studied the challenges of public sector management will also be very aware of these barriers. So the first is that government work is still primarily organized into silos, and it's very difficult to introduce systems thinking approaches, and often innovation processes demand that you get out of kind of strict disciplinary or departmental or even the kind of limited view of your particular policy shop. And for a whole range of reasons, you know, governments have long pursued the kind of the holy grail of horizontal government, of coordinating across ministries, of better working with other sectors. And there are reasons why this is challenging. You know, we operate in a system of vertical accountability, which can complicate your ability to collaborate across different departments or with other sectors. It can be difficult, of course, for even just the practicalities of like sharing information effectively, even finding like time and places to meet. Like, how do you, you know, the more players you bring into a process, the more complicated and time-consuming it can become. But innovation, it turns out, is very difficult to do if you are organizing your work by institutional structures that were developed for very different reasons than solving problems that actually exist in society, which often demand that you sort of break out of those silos. So one example where, say, the federal government did this very well was when it first developed websites. Canada became a kind of global leader in the late 90s, because it didn't organize the federal government's website as kind of strictly by department. They said, okay, well, citizens who come to our website are interested in like certain activities. Like, they're here because they're having a baby, or they need to figure out how to solve a problem with their taxes, or they're traveling and they want to know if their passport's up to date and what the restrictions are on travel. So why don't we organize our website more around user needs and kind of think in that way, as opposed to here's the, you know, Passport Canada, and here's, at the time would have been Human Resources and Skills Development Canada, et cetera. And this was like mind-blowing to people, the idea that you would present the face of government as not organized by ministry, but rather by user need. Now, globally, this has become the big trend, and Canada was on the cutting edge of this, a great example of an innovation that resulted from kind of systems thinking and breaking down silos. But again, very rare to see that happen. The second reason that innovation can be difficult in the public service, or in any large bureaucracy for that matter, is because of excessive hierarchy, which can lead to weak information flows. So on the one hand, if you have a really great idea from what you as sort of a junior policy analyst have observed about your stakeholders or certain research that's emerging in your policy area, or what you're learning from users of your service, there are many, many layers in the kind of chain of command that would need to go through before it actually got to someone with the power to act on it. And so the vertical information flow is kind of very blocked up in governments. Also, there's many layers of approval before you can actually take any action. And so there's very limited agency at lower levels. Now, again, that's for very good reasons. We operate in a system of hierarchical accountability. We don't want sort of lower level individuals going rogue and just making large decisions without having the approval of, you know, their manager and all ultimately the minister, if it's, you know, an issue that isn't so operational in nature that the minister should be getting involved. I'm not saying that. That's a bit of a caricature of this argument. But it's simply to say that when we look at innovative organizations, they're implementing practices and sort of processes that allow those at lower chains of command to have a little bit more discretion and to be a bit more entrepreneurial in how they, say, design their programs or engage with stakeholders. And this is really essential, kind of infusing that spirit of kind of grassroots agency and engagement is really crucial to building an innovative workforce, and not something governments have traditionally been very good at. The third big barrier, and it's kind of related to the second one, is that government bureaucracies have, in many cases, developed too many rules. Or there are perceived rules that don't even exist. And coupled with that is sort of growth and oversight and a related reporting burden. So I'll break all of these down. So again, if you take an example like the federal government, you have the Treasury Board Secretariat, which is sort of like the bureaucracy's bureaucracy, producing a whole range of rules to govern everything from how government departments communicate, to the processes by which they ask for money, to how they might engage Canadians on issues. So there's elaborate and dense rules that have developed around almost all program, any activity you could take on in government. Treasury Board has some rules on it. And many have argued, and I think convincingly, that the kind of web of rules to which public servants are subject has become far too dense and complex, and it's stifling your ability to, in many cases, to just try new things. And in many cases, these rules are also completely sort of out of whack with an age defined by sort of rapid information flows and very different citizen expectations for how government should operate. And I'll give a case study example of that later. We look at how the federal government first adapted is a generous term, social media. All that to say, another big problem is that the public service over the years has also kind of developed a risk-averse sort of default presumption that Treasury Board rules apply where they don't. So there's kind of like a mission creep on a lot of the Treasury Board instruments, so people will apply them to areas that they don't necessarily apply to. Also, just generally perceiving that you can't do something when the rules do allow you to do it. So a concrete example there would be, I've talked to public servants who think they can't monitor citizens, a hashtag being used on Twitter that relates to their department and some program or policy initiative they have, because if they were to do that and systematically monitor that, it would count as public opinion research, which would mean that they would have to go through the elaborate public opinion research back and forth approval process, which involves Treasury Board Secretariat, Public Services and Procurement Canada, Privy Council Office, and many, many chains of back and forth approvals, and it would take so long to actually have it designed and planned and executed that whatever they were planning on following on Twitter would be long gone, right? Actually, if you speak to the people in the Privy Council Office and Public Services Procurement Canada who run and who manage this suite of rules, they said, no, it would never apply to that. That's not a thing. That this public opinion research is, when we contract in formal surveys, like through a consulting company or through a polling company. So there is this, also public servants are kind of the blame in that they sort of assume rules apply when they don't, and that can undercut experimentation with innovative policy approaches. The last two is sort of growth and oversight in the reporting burden. So you have also seen in kind of recent years a proliferation of agents and officers of parliament, and with that comes, on the one hand, kind of more rules that you need to follow, but also more reports that need to be written and more kind of accountability structures. Now again, I'm not saying these are bad things. A lot of the reason these rules proliferated was in part in response to something like the sponsorship scandal. So, we do want to maintain accountability. My argument is not to sort of throw out hierarchy or throw out rules, but there is a legitimate case to be made to kind of examine what we have in the books right now, cut out rules that don't make sense, and streamline those that have become far too dense, and also to do some myth busting on the idea of rules applying in certain places when they really don't. The fourth, which is a really big one, and actually has only really come up in the last few years, when governments got over the first sort of fear of working with new policy instruments like social media or big data, and then tried to do it and realized that no one could, like no one in the department knew how to do any of these things. So they were either sort of reliant on outside contractors who would provide, reports and analyses of varying quality, and governments wouldn't have much power to question it. I remember in Ottawa, a consultant who did social network analysis of social media channels like Facebook and Twitter told me that he could sit in a room with executives from the public service and say that a network graph that he had crafted from scraping tweets from Twitter told them A or told them B, and they would have no way to even understand what it was telling them, and they'd go, sounds good. So, you know, you can kind of be sold magic beans if you don't actually have internal capacity to consume some of these new sources of information. So this is another big barrier. It's just skills gaps. The capacity gap is not just about new skill sets required for a lot of these new approaches to policy, like design thinking, let's say, or behavioral economics, but also just, you know, generally sort of cuts to the public service over the years, questions around the extent to which we've been investing in the policy capacity in general. This is, again, it's hard. Innovation doesn't come for free. It might have the long-term goal of allowing you to do more with less, but at least in the sort of short and medium term, it does demand an incredible amount of investment. And in particular, in jurisdictions that were deeply affected by the global financial crisis, a drive for innovation, which asks for more money to hire in new skills and invest in the capacity of the policy shop, is a hard ask. The fifth one is a big one, and this is demands for error-free government from managers and from ministers in particular, and our competitive, scandal-hungry political culture. So if you'll remember, I said, you know, innovation also demands a tolerance and willingness to fail, to try new things that aren't tested and aren't proven. And, you know, there are, we sort of live in a world that doesn't quite rationalize that, doesn't really provide the incentives and motivations to try new things. And often when you talk to those in the public service about why they don't innovate, why they're not trying new things in their area, even though, say, other jurisdictions have, or where there's evidence that a different approach might work better, they go, oh, well, like, I don't want to fail the Globe and Mail test. Like, if it doesn't go right and my minister's on the cover of the paper tomorrow, I'm done. And so in that context, you know, on the one hand, you're like, well, that's terrible because, you know, many people say, oh, the public service is too risk averse. I would say actually there's an incredible risk tolerance in the public service because sort of blindly sticking to the status quo, even when you know it leads to suboptimal outcomes, which we do in many ways, that's just invites an incredible amount of risk. What we have is a status quo bias, a sort of a better the devil you know type logic. I don't want to be the manager that tried something different and it didn't work out. And, you know, later in the presentation, I'll talk a little bit about the role I think we have to play in not fueling this kind of a political culture, in particular, and how we respond to governments, whether punishing or rewarding them for trying something different. And I don't think that the media, I don't think citizens, and I don't think opposition parties, for example, are sort of doing their part in encouraging a public service that can sort of embrace the change and uncertainty that innovation can demand. You know, so I don't want to make sort of completely blame ministers for this. I think that in many cases they're responding to the incentives that are placed before them, and they're responding to an environment where error-free government as a demand kind of makes sense because they'll get sort of raked over the coals if things don't necessarily work out perfectly. So, as I say, to sum up here, in this context, instead of seeing innovation, we tend to see status quo biases emerge, especially amongst middle managers. This increasingly comes up in the research that it's like the top level of government gets it and they're like, oh, we need to be more open, we need to try new approaches to policy work, we need to embrace new collaborations and new types of data. And then those in the bottom level are like, yes, that totally makes sense, I'm really excited, I'm a new public servant and I think this is great. And then the middle manager is sort of the clay layer where the good ideas go to die. I had one public servant explain to me that it kind of makes sense when you think about the fact that those up and coming aren't jaded yet and don't have anything to lose and they want to prove themselves as being innovative. And those at the top, like the deputy minister, has already made it and they're happy to leave a little bit of a legacy if something works out. And, well, if it doesn't work out, you know, what are they, like, sure they serve at the pleasure of the prime minister, but they're probably not going to lose their job over something, an innovation that failed. Whereas the middle managers are operating in a system that has rewarded risk aversion. And the way they get promoted is by having a unit that kind of stays the course. And this is a huge problem. Micromanaging, as a result, also becomes rewarded. Rules proliferate because the reaction to anything new and unknown is to just sort of drown it in Treasury Board rules in order to ensure that it doesn't lead to anything new and surprising and that you won't get blamed when you didn't kind of rule the death out of something interesting. Again, driven by a fear of failing, so something like the Globe and Mail test is sort of a driving ethos. And this idea that Savoy points out in 2013 and that I think is, you know, does predate in many ways the kind of digital age and this new push for innovation, which is that there is an attitude in government that it's better to avoid sin than to ask, than to ask for forgiveness. So again, just sort of stick with the course, stay the course. Even if it means the course is eventually bound to crash. So here's a case study to illustrate how this happened in practice. So in 2000, and so how did the federal government respond to social media, basically? So in 2007, federal government commissioned public opinion research, so a large-scale poll on social media and government, basically asked citizens, what do you think government should do with these new tools? And it showed, it's fascinating research, and it doesn't get talked about enough. It shows that citizens actually had a very high demand for use of social media and government, for things like improving service delivery, but they also said for things like making government more trustworthy, more accessible, making government more responsive. So they really thought that it would improve governance. In response to this, we get 3.5 years of internal corporate policy development, largely driven by a Treasury Board Secretariat, where there was, you know, complex debates and countless meetings, and who knows how many decks created to sort of figure out how to respond to social media and what should the rules be and what are all the policy considerations. Eventually, social media was primarily just siloed off to communications offices. So instead of it being defined broadly as a tool, as a new policy instrument that all policy analysts should benefit from, let's say to follow research in your policy area, to engage with stakeholders, to identify trends and emerging issues in your field, no. In fact, there were firewalls put up and social media was blocked in large part across all government, a few exceptions here and there. Like Foreign Affairs, for example, kept access open. And it was just sort of used as a tool to push information out, managed through the communication shop. The eventual TBS policy that resulted after 3.5 years was over 12,000 words long. And if you read it, one blogger called it the Guideline for Digital Oblivion. Because really, if you want to see how government can sort of rule away scope for trying something new, you read that policy. And after, it would terrify you. Like, it makes it seem like social media could very well invite the collapse of the public service as we know it. And when you speak to those who created it, they were aware that it was very kind of risk averse and that it mentioned, you know, a whole slew of policy considerations that people should take into account before they use social media. But they were, it was tricky because they were sort of speaking the language of those very risk-averse managers that I was talking about earlier. And their strategy was to try to show them how social media could be made compatible with all of the various existing Treasury Board rules around official languages, privacy considerations, neutrality of the public service, and to things like the federal identity policies, so making sure that you're not betraying kind of common looks and feel of government communications. And so their hearts were in the right place. They were trying to convince these managers by making a really long, dense document that, look, we've thought through all this. But it actually had the opposite effect of basically telling anybody in the public service outside the communication shop to like never touch social media because there were so many risks at play that it did not make sense to even think about it. It also resulted in hilarious things, depressing things as well, like tweet approval processes, which are like possibly the most bureaucratic response to something like social media, where you saw things like between 9 and 12 steps in some cases, including ministerial sign-off, I heard in one department, for a retweet. You had to get the minister to sign off on a retweet. I mean, like, this is not a good use of a minister's time, I would say. It also resulted in an incredible amount of negative press for government. So things like the Canadian Press wrote, pity the poor government tweet, nearly strangled in its cradle before limping into the Twitterverse. And this is one of many critical media pieces that had been written in response to government's sort of incapacity to keep up with the times. Ironically enough, if the whole premise of sort of avoiding, and this is what I mean by kind of, it's not about not having a risk tolerance, it's actually a very risky business to not embrace innovation, because the whole goal of not being on the cover of the Globe and Mail, not embarrassing your minister, actually they didn't even achieve that, because in being risk averse and fearing, you know, an attempt to try something new, they did end up getting the negative press. And certainly this does very little to convince Canadians that government is sort of a reliable, resilient, kind of relevant actor. When you hear things like, oh, government takes 12 steps to tweet, like, the jokes abound and notions of sort of paper pushing, wasteful bureaucrats, you know, you're kind of fueling that stereotype.
So I return again to the waterfall. I mean, that's just one example of social media, but you know, there have been however many technological innovations and new trends that have hit the agenda since, that governments are sort of wholly unprepared in many cases to embrace. And just some of the emerging ones that I think they're really not sort of doing a good enough job getting ready for. Not exclusively, but are things like, again, robotics and the role that might play in service delivery going forward, and the ethics and the ethical implications that implies. How governments can use our data. Now, there is some discussion on that, but the conversation hasn't been particularly progressive. There's a lot of reliance on what I would say are old and outdated ideas in the Privacy Act that are really limiting scope for innovation, artificial intelligence and how this might be better integrated into policy analysis, even just innovative approaches to engaging with stakeholders, things like design thinking. And you know, these are very much kind of, again, on the fringes. They sometimes happen, they're pilots, but they're not being integrated at nearly a quick enough pace for government to anticipate, to keep up with trends that were sort of mainstream 4 years ago. I read an email from the former chief statistician of Canada, which said that as of 2014, they were just sort of experimenting with and considering what big data might mean for policy. I mean, this is like one of the centers of kind of data collection and data analysis in the public service, and viewing big data in 2014 as an emerging trend that you might want to consider is just simply not good enough. You know, that's already, I would say, 4 years behind the times. So this is sort of what I would say is at stake here. Like, why is this important? Why is this something we need to be caring about? On the horizon, I would say that there are significant policy and service failures that are going to emerge, and many that already have, because of a lack of a capacity to either sort of anticipate and respond to emerging policy and regulatory challenges, or even to benefit from new sources of data and information that are swirling through our societies. It's only going to take a case where there's some natural disaster or policy fiasco in which an outsider who does have the skills can say, oh, well, actually, look, I was following this issue on social media. I visualized this and anticipated it coming. You could have done that too. You didn't, because you haven't been building that capacity. Even something like the Phoenix pay system disaster, there are lots of reasons why that emerged, a lot of sort of just traditional management problems, but one of the big problems was that government is still managing IT projects in a very backwards way, ignoring some of the more agile approaches that are being taken in other jurisdictions, in which you would never roll out a large-scale project, a sort of implementation of, administering checks to a complex bureaucracy of however many, 240,000 people, without having sort of carefully piloted and tested that initiative. That's part of the sort of innovative approach, and in particular, the design thinking, user-centered design that is sort of sweeping the IT world by storm and leading to incredible innovations outside government, wasn't applied in the case of Phoenix, and I think that's a large reason why that failure emerged. And we're only, you know, now still trying to come to terms with this and what its long-term impacts are going to be. The third point is that there's, I think, significant human resource issues as well. So if you are operating in an environment where there are 12 steps to tweet, where you're blocking access to not just social media, but also blocking access to a lot of relevant online policy tools, even something like Google Drive is blocked on many public servants' computers, are you really creating an attractive workforce for future employees who've kind of developed skills that capitalize on these tools? Even just the image of the public service as one that's sort of regularly criticized in the media for being behind the times on certain new technologies, I would say, doesn't do much to kind of bolster its reputation as the employer of choice. And then retaining and leveraging that talent. So you often hear, like, I've had some pretty depressing interviews with new public servants in the federal government who talk about how they came in with so much enthusiasm for a career in the public service and just feel completely bogged down by the incredible hierarchy they face, by the inability to embrace new policy instruments, to use the tools they're used to using in their daily work. And then the last point, which is probably the most important, is that there is a real risk of a loss of legitimacy and trust from citizens if government is A, suffering from policy failures by not innovating, or B, continuing to demonstrate itself as not very responsive to new trends or able to sort of weather the changes of the day. But the last point is also political masters. I mean, if the public service can't keep pace with new trends and new opportunities to work with new types of data or new instruments, and even, again, to avoid some of those policy failures that might come from a strict status quo kind of default, ministers may increasingly turn to other sources of insight, because why would they? What is the kind of value proposition of a public service that can't keep pace when you've got external bodies who are increasingly building these capacities? If you look at the big consultancy firms or policy think tanks, they're bringing in data scientists, they're recruiting people with expertise in behavioral insights, design thinking. So what is it that the public service is going to offer in lieu of these outside actors? There's still a value proposition in terms of, you know, the permanency, the neutral advice, but if that advice is not based on the best information or is sort of necessarily status quo, defaults to the status quo, again, there are reasons to question its value going forward. So I'll close quickly with some practical and, as I say, some idealistic strategies to push this agenda forward and then open it up for discussion. The first that some talk about is that you need positive policy statements to challenge status quo defaults. And so this is basically what these end up looking like, is kind of top-down statements, sometimes from the political level, often from the political level, that kind of mandate certain activities. So the UK government in 2012, in their civil service reform plan, stated that open policy making will become the default. And it wasn't just said, there were also sort of directives that were attached to that. Under Obama, there was an executive order to kind of streamline service delivery and to encourage kind of the digitization of services. Again, I would say that Trudeau government's introduction of this experimentation commitment, stating that a fixed percentage of all program funds need to be dedicated to experimentation and by virtue of that sort of to promote innovation, that's another sort of very concrete positive policy statement that can jolt the bureaucracy out of its status quo default. Because now it's something that you have to do, and not only that, but you can kind of hang your fear of, like, you're not rocking the boat as a manager who's trying something different, you're actually just going with the stream because you're supposed to be doing this. So it makes it easier for kind of these risks, these new approaches to be taken. And again, risk, because I really do think that the greatest risk the public service faces now is by sticking with the status quo, even when we know it's in some cases definitely not optimal, and in other cases potentially not optimal. Second, I talked a lot about kind of the complexity, the web of rules that public servants face now. Many of these rules can be streamlined. Again, the federal government right now, I think, has done a good job, for example, in streamlining the communications policy. A lot of that work, to be clear, did start under Harper. In the last sort of year and a half of, I think it was the last year and a half, there was this TBS policy reset, but it sort of was finally introduced under Trudeau. So the communications policy, I think, was slashed maybe in half in terms of words. Why does that matter? Well, because if you want to just sort of convince a public servant, a manager in particular, that some new approach to communicating and engaging with Canadians aligns with existing policies, it's helpful if that policy is sort of short and sweet and easy to read and doesn't, like, freak you out with the number of policy considerations and risks it raises. In other cases, I actually think we need to create new rules. So again, following the guideline of make them easy to understand, don't freak people out, use clear language, streamline. But there are some new policy instruments that are operating in a little bit of a wild west, and I think some new rules to sort of enable and encourage public servants to use them would be helpful. So an example there would be, I discussed earlier, social media monitoring and how this could fit into sort of a new policy tool for governments. Yes, they have clarified at the federal level that it's not public opinion research, but we also do need some rules to guide sort of when is it appropriate and not for public servants to scrape data from the web and use it to inform policy. How do we anonymize that data? How do we store it? How can we link it up? These are legitimate questions that I think do raise some accountability issues that, you know, some helpful positive, encouraging, but, you know, accountable rules on those would be useful. So we need some new rules as well. Three, again, recruiting new talent. There's lots of ways this could be done. Interchanges, I think, are a great idea that the public service does not make enough use of, but that, you know, there's a lot of people right now, I'd say at the federal level, who've kind of proposed interchange. So whether that's with the private sector, the academic sector, nonprofit sector, other governments. New hiring streams and recruitment targets. So not just looking to your typical kind of economics, policy, law, public policy. I mean, I shouldn't say this because I teach in a public policy school, but I think you'll need those traditional skills and that awareness of the policy world. You're also gonna need to bring in maybe anthropologists for things like design thinking. You're gonna need to bring in data scientists, those who have capacity to do sort of the big data analytics. Designers, you're going to need those with behavioral insights. So these are kind of skills that we don't really have in the kind of in the halls of government right now, and that's just a very simple but straightforward barrier that kind of in many cases is the non-starter. Like, you can have a risk-tolerant manager and a positive policy statement and a willingness to go forward and try, I don't know, an A-B testing on a form for your service. But if you don't actually have someone who knows how to do that, it kind of ends there. And then developing things like hubs and labs as sort of unique spaces to recruit unconventional talent into government, sometimes they can be a little bit more appealing, in particular on the digital side. So you're seeing this happen with something like the government digital service in the UK, the US digital service. Ontario's digital team is another great example of this, where you're bringing in those who might other work for Google and Shopify by creating a space in government that in many ways sort of ignore and defies a lot of the strict hierarchy, silos, risk aversion that the rest of the bureaucracy suffers with. There's some problems with those hubs too that I'm happy to talk about during the Q&A, but I do think they're an interesting way of recruiting new talent to government. Fourth, this is a little hard to operationalize, but there's some ways you can do it. It's to really promote and reward, in particular, middle managers that lead innovation. So this could be something that we say that we want to see innovation, and then again, as I said, it often dies kind of at the middle manager level. So how can we ensure that those who are actually kind of leading the charge are the ones who are riding up to AD admin and deputy minister positions, as opposed to the opposite? And there's a general assumption that, I think a general agreement that in the past, you know, 15, 20 years, it hasn't always been that innovation was clearly rewarded. Of course, there's questions there about how you demonstrate that. And, you know, I've been trying to work through some ways that you might do that, and it's not impossible, but certainly we can do better than we are right now. Fifth, and this is the most difficult one, because many of these levers are not in the public service, but I do think we need to build a political culture that's hungry for innovation and tolerant of failure. It's very difficult to encourage the public service to try new things and take risks. Of course, as we discussed, when outside government, you have a media sort of that pounces on the sensationalist kind of gotcha style stories. And when you've got citizens that are quick to sort of assume the worst of government, there are some really concrete examples where I think governments have tried innovative things and the media didn't treat them very fairly for it. When things didn't work out perfectly, or they just completely misunderstood what they were trying to do. So an example of that would be like the federal government. There's a bot on Twitter that tracks edits to Wikipedia coming out of the federal government, and there have been 5 or 10 different articles claiming this as sort of wasteful public servants. Why are they editing Wikipedia? And yes, some of the edits are not particularly work-related, like editing an article on the chocolate bar or something like that, or a sports game. Some of them are a little bit more racy than that. But, you know, like a fair assessment of that would be, okay, this is a small number of edits. Many of them are, potentially these people are on break. And third, like that's a thing, you know, public servants take breaks. And then finally, and most importantly, if we live in an age where most of us get our information from Wikipedia, Google is looped into Wikipedia to the point that when you search the internet, you're probably going to get an answer from Wikipedia. I think it's like over 500 million people. Is it daily? Regardless, lots of people are on Wikipedia. So I actually think that a public servant who is editing information on Wikipedia should be rewarded for that. Okay, chocolate bar, not relevant to the work, but what the media stories ignored was public servant from Canadian Heritage editing the page on Canada's 150th anniversary. public servant from Indigenous and Northern Affairs Canada, editing a page on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission with like a fully factual, neutral correction of or update of a topic. Changing the name of a minister after a shuffle. Like, I think the public servant doing that is exactly the kind of innovative, networked, open public servant who is embracing the reality of the digital age that we should reward. But the media kind of, again, rakes them over the coals, and then there's a witch hunt that you always hear about in the department where some manager's like, who edited that? Ah! And the message is, of course, chilling effect across the rest of the public service. Don't be original. Don't try anything different. Don't think about the internet as a thing that matters to people. It's a problem. So, you know, we have a role to play as well, and I think So these would be my recommendations to actually build that culture. Public servants have a role to play. They have to rebuild trust with citizens. I think they should discuss their work more. I think they have to explain their failures, and they have to celebrate their successes. If you look at the really innovative units in government or governments globally, they do a lot more of the first one. Like they have a very strong relationship with the public, and it builds that trust that means there's more empathy and understanding outside government of what government is trying to do, and it can create space to be innovative. The second is political leaders need to demand innovation. Something like the experimentation commitment is a good example of that. And they also have to openly acknowledge and allow for the risk of failure that comes with innovation. Graham Flack, who's the Deputy Minister of Canadian Heritage and was on a panel this week that I was moderating, he was talking about how, you know, innovation without failure is like Putin without calories, which I think is a really great way to put it, because they go hand in hand, and you can't as a political leader ask for the former and not say openly, I'm okay with the latter. Well-managed failure, you know, we're not talking about like Phoenix here or, you know, other legitimate failures, but I think something like, again, the current Liberal government has done a good job in the mandate letters openly saying, if you look at them in the preamble that every single minister got, there is a line to the effect of, Canadians don't expect us to be perfect. When we make mistakes, we need to acknowledge them, we need to explain them, and we need to sort of move on from them and learn from them. That approach of sort of accountability for learning is really, really missing in the way we manage in the public service and the way our political leaders have traditionally interfaced with the public service. And I think we haven't seen the previous federal mandate letters because they've never been made public, but I would guess they didn't include some sort of a mention. They did not overly emphasize, you know, I'm okay with you failing, let's just talk about it and make it open. And then the third, again, citizens, media, and opposition parties, or broadly speaking, not just in terms of political parties, but lobbyists, advocacy groups, whatever, they need to reward innovation more. Like, when government does something interesting, we need more media reports that accurately cover that, because there just aren't many, probably because we don't click on them. So we also have a role to play in like, being hungry for government to do something right and rewarding that. Being open-minded and tolerant of reasonable failures, a reasonable underscore. So, you know, we do still need to properly punish unacceptable failures, like the Phoenix pay system. That too drives innovation, I think, because it can demonstrate in cases where you did just stick with the status quo approach and failure emerged, you're going to be punished for it. But, I mean, look, for example, at the way Canadians responded to the return of the long-form census. That sort of overwhelming groundswell of popular support, I think, sends a potent message to political leaders. Like, Canadians actually like when you support evidence. They respect this sign of a return to sort of evidence-based decision-making. Good governance is something that can get you rewarded at the polls. Like, we need to send more of those signals if we actually want our political leaders to offer that to us when they govern or when they're asking for us to vote for them at election time. I'm just going to leave it on this final slide, which is why I think this matters. I think there are huge, huge stakes at play in our ability to innovate or not. And it is entirely possible that in sort of 10, 15 years, this same presentation could be given, right? Like, I don't presume change here. Like, there are a lot of things that could go wrong. The current government, I've said a lot of good things about. They haven't faced a giant, giant scandal yet. I mean, the first time that they try something different and there's a huge failure, that will be, I think, the test of their commitment to actually encouraging innovative policymaking and approaches to engaging Canadians and engaging with evidence and data. But again, there, it's not just a political problem. There's also a lot of kind of institutional and cultural defaults in the public service that mean this is a hard sort of change to implement. So, I mean, in many cases, it falls on you, emerging leaders in the public service. I think it falls to the academics in the room to continue to study innovation and why it happens or not, and to push that agenda. And again, all of us as citizens, I think, do have a very big role to play in kind of rewarding governments that actually try different things and that aren't afraid to sort of embrace the small-scale failures that pave the path to kind of large-scale innovations. Thank you.